Kerrang Radio, I'm Louise Molony. Natalie Dormer, thank you so much for joining me in the studio. We, of course, recognise you from Game of Thrones and Hunger Games.
Mm-hmm.
So you're kind of partial to a dark character. But today we're here to talk about the forest.
We are, very dark.
Yes, very dark. Sarah in the forest. Tell me all about it, Natalie.
So you meet Sarah. She looks like the perfect woman. Great house, great husband, great job. She gets a phone call and she's been being told by the Japanese authorities that her identical twin sister, Jess, has disappeared into the Okagahara forest, the suicide forest, and they won't be looking for her because as far as they're concerned, she's dead. And Sarah immediately disagrees. She can feel through a sixth sense that she has with her sister that her sister's alive. So she gets on a plane, travels halfway across the world, and against all warning and better judgment, goes into the forest, leaves the path, which is the one rule, do not leave the path, find someone to take her in and be a guide, and goes in search of her sister. And instead, what ends up happening is she ends up sort of finding her own inner demons. And then the jumps and the scares really rack up.
So it is, you've kind of gone to full-on horror in the forest.
Mm.
What did you do to prepare for that? Or what was the process that you used in order to kind of really get yourself prepared for this role?
Well, you know, it's the beauty of this job was we shot in sequence, and you never do that. That's so unheard of in movie making, to shoot in chronological order. And it was a choice that, you know, the director, the producers and I all sort of came to because we could. So if we could, why not? And it helped with continuity, hair and makeup. As people will see, I slowly get more and more rough looking because get dirtier and the blood and the... and more tired and more disheveled. And it really helped me with the mental breakdown as well, because Sarah, bless her, she does really kind of descend into madness.
That's interesting, because I was going to ask you, watching it, it's kind of edge of your seat, kind of jump out of your skin, mm. sort of horror. Did you find shooting some of those scenes emotionally draining? Because I was emotionally drained watching them.
Mm.
Did you kind of go home and go, This is a tough one now?
Yeah, it was tiring. And, you know, I like a cardiovascular workout like the rest of them. But, I mean, it did. You're quite right. I got quite tired. And the emotionally draining as well. When you're playing scared and tense and frightened and anxious a lot. I mean, because your muscles don't know any different. You know, they think it's happening for real. You know, when you get a role like that, that's very liberating as well. When you've been playing, I mean, I love Marge. But when you've been sitting around in long silk skirts for a number of months, to actually like really push yourself to mental and physical limits like that is very liberating.
So we have touched on Queen Margaery. Series 6 trailer has just come out this week. Have you seen it?
I have. I watched it last night.
Okay, go on. Tell me, what did you think?
Well, I just like I love it. They're always a bit obscure about it. They like to keep people on their toes.
So I take it you can't tell us anything about it at this point.
Nada. Sorry.
How has it been shooting it anyway?
A lot of fun. Always. You know, it's like it's the longest I've ever played a character now. 5 years. It's my fifth year with Marge, and it's just so lovely. As a family coming back together, because we have, you know, 6 months on, 6 months off. So we all go off and do other projects. So it always feels like a bit of a catch up and like going back to school a bit, you know, when we're all hanging out again.
That's so nice.
Yeah,
it is. You have that.
It is really great. And I enjoy watching everyone else's projects and what they've done in between and talking to them about it and catching up. And the other great thing about Game of Thrones is you're never really quite sure who your next season is going to be with, who your sparring partner is going to be, because they like to, you know, shift it up. You know, I can, 1 year I was very much with Sophie Turner as Sansa, or another year I'm very much with Lena as Cersei, and my sparring partner changed this season.
Has it
so,
indeed?
So that was great to become good friends and have some fun with another person. So
you're forming new relationships on the show the whole time.
Yeah.
How nice.
Nice.
Are you excited to see the new series? Are you a fan?
I'm a massive fan.
Okay.
And so I don't read anyone else's storylines on purpose. I only read in my scripts the King's Landing scenes so that I don't know. It means I can, you know, when April comes, I'm as excited as everyone else.
Are you?
And,
yeah.
Yeah, and I sit down and watch it on my sofa in real time every week the way the viewers do. I mean, that's how I came to the show in season one when I wasn't a part of it. So I really enjoy like going back to that. And obviously this is the first year where we don't have the source material in the books.
Of course.
It's extra exciting. Yeah, I mean, when they did what they did to Sean Bean's character at the end of season one, I was like shouting at the TV. I was like, that's genius.
So friends and I spent the weekend playing Snog, Marry, Avoid. Would you be interested in a game?
Oh, go on then. You twisted my arm.
Brilliant. Now, this is Game of Thrones characters, not the real people, just their characters.
Okay.
Past and present. So Snog, Marry, Avoid, Joffrey, Theon, a.k.a. Reek, or Ramsay Bolton?
Well, I'd probably snog Theon because... if he's Theon as Theon and not Reek,
okay.
That's how I'm going to cheat. That's how I'm going to cheat.
Right,
he was a half decent human being when he was still very much Stark in his ethos.
He was. I like the way you're thinking.
So
okay.
I'll snog Theon. I'll marry Joffrey because I know how to handle him. I've done it already.
Good woman, I like
definitely
that.
Avoid Ramsay Snow. That man is.
I often wondered, would
evil.
It be better to marry Joffrey or Ramsay? So you're going to say Joffrey.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
But maybe that's just because better the devil you know.
Totally. Okay. This is an interesting one. Peter Baelish, Ned Stark, or Tywin Lannister?
Marry Ned.
Me too.
Snog Littlefinger. And, yeah.
Avoid Tywin.
Although that's really cruel to Charles Dance.
Who's, yeah, but we're this isn't personal.
That's true. Because if it was Charles Dance, he's a bit of a lovey. I probably, you know... might be tempted to snog.
Okay, good to know. I really have a crush on him, I have to say. And finally, the last one, Jon Snow, Robb Stark, or Jaime Lannister?
Well, Jon Snow's so preoccupied. You'd marry Robb, you know.
Can I just say, I love the way you're thinking about this.
I'm really giving you serious consideration. I'd probably, well, you know, Jon Snow's dead, so I'd avoid him.
Well, okay. Okay, fair enough. Okay.
And I'd probably be interested in... Jamie
Lannister.
Yeah, I'd probably be interested in snogging Nikolai. I mean, what woman wouldn't be?
Absolutely.
So, yeah.
And so you'd marry Robb Stark?
Yeah.
Good to know.